One is, I would say, get a good mathematical foundation, like really before you even enter like a master's program. Don't go into a master's program like starting from zero or close to zero. I think that's really not a great use of the time. There are resources you can access. There's actually a free textbook that I used, and it was, I think it was called Mathematics for Machine Learning, where the authors like make it free, the PDF free online. But there are other resources. Maybe you go to Coursera or something like that and do something. Another one I have that I wish I knew that is a good practical advice, I think, is learn how to use a lot of Python libraries, obviously, that are relevant to data science. And what I mean by that is, so they're the ones that like everyone's gonna use anyway for deep learning, like TensorFlow or scikit-learn for machine learning. You should certainly learn all of those, but other ones too, like Flask for how to deploy a web API. There's other mathematical ones, NumPy, pandas for data manipulation. You really have to be very good with that. Not just like okay with it, you have to be very good with it. That's a little bit later. I think if you're just starting your data science journey, like don't worry about that too much. You know, start with, you know, you might start with some of the basics, you know, NumPy and all that, or maybe just start like learning pandas for, you know, learning how to use data frames a little bit. But I think as you get closer to the end, you really have to start paying more attention to that stuff. The other thing I would add, which goes along with that, is learn how to deploy models in production. I think that's getting more and more common. I think it used to be when you were a data scientist that you can generate models and you just hand them off to someone else and they worry about how to get it into production. But nowadays, it's kind of expected that you know at least the fundamentals of that. So that's things like, I'm going to mention a few technical things, but like speaking of Python libraries and related stuff, you know, using Docker for containerizing your applications, using things like Amazon Web Services or Google Cloud or Azure, they all do the same thing, but maybe like focus on one and learn how to deploy machine learning algorithms on that. Now there are even courses you can take that teach that, because when you're first learning, you're not going to focus on that stuff at all. You're going to focus on how do I even create a machine learning model? And it is important to understand that. But eventually, if you want to do something in the real world, then you have to learn how to do real world applications. So that's another bit of advice. Let's see, is there anything else? There's probably lots of other little things, but those are the ones that kind of I experience the most. Oh, actually, I do have one more.
Oh, perfect.
So I'm sorry. Which is, if you have domain knowledge in a certain area, kind of use that to your advantage, because I think the data science in general as a discipline, I think, is splintering more and more where people have kind of specialties. And I think one of the things that is a trend that we're starting to see that we're going to see more of too are people who don't, their job title may not necessarily be data scientist, but that is in fact what you're doing. But it might be in some specific domain, healthcare, economics, or certain types of businesses. It can be a lot of things. So if you have a background where you already have some domain expertise, consider finding a way of merging that with data science skills, and you may find it down the road easier to find work if you can do that. Yes, so the company is called Inclusively, and it's a startup, although we're growing. It's been around for about a year and a half, a little over a year and a half. And what the company is in short, it's a job board designed for people with disabilities. So the overall mission is to make a more inclusive workplace. In terms of machine learning and artificial intelligence, what we are trying to do, or what we have done, we're expanding on, is basically making job matching technology. And there's already a lot of job AI matching out there, but not much in the way of people with disabilities. So what I'm trying to do is make AI that will help match users to jobs, both from the user perspective and the employer perspective, right? So from the employer perspective, find candidates that have the particular skills that they need in order to do the job. But we don't use a lot of the tricks that a lot of other AI software that does similar things uses. So for example, we don't screen out users that have gaps in their resumes. That's a lot. A lot of people with disabilities end up with gaps in their resumes for various reasons, and because of that, they end up getting screened out by existing job matching AI. In many cases, without them even realizing it. That's just one example that I'm using, but there are a lot of these examples. So what I'm trying to do is to create AI that does not have these inherent biases for people with disabilities, but at the same time solves the problem for employers of, let's find people that, depending on the nature of the job, are able to do this job and then get them to apply. All right, so this is one piece here of where I, you know, may start on a machine learning project. So here I'm doing some data labeling. You know, in when you're working for data science and business, you have to create your own data sets. And so what I'm doing is trying to match, you know, our users to jobs on the platform. And there are different ways we can do that. One of them is what I'm trying to do here, which is in natural language processing and NLP, this is called named entity recognition, where we want the machine learning model to be able to recognize certain words or phrases as belonging to a particular category. So the first step to do that is to label it. So here I have to go through, and I go through a bunch of jobs one by one, do this many times, where I'm, you know, the type of degree, in this case, field of study, you know, how much experience time it's asking for. And then here I've labeled all these programming languages so that it recognizes, you know, either software or programming languages that are required for the job. And most data scientists, you know, use tools like this in order to label the data. You have to get it, you know, very accurate if you want your model to perform well. It's actually fairly rare that you can do that, you know, just using Python scripts or something like that. So, you know, it can be a little bit tedious, but you do have to pay very close attention to what you're doing, and, you know, how you label it affects how your model performs. So as an example of kind of another step in this process, so that might, you know, allow me to label and export it. And then, you know, you have to do a lot of data pre-processing. So here are a couple examples of that. Here's a Python file that I wrote. And what this file is doing is it's, you know, first it's accessing our database. We use the PostgreSQL. And we're also using Spacy here, which is that's a Python library for natural language processing that I like very much. It's very powerful. And so, you know, here's a, you know, function that removes HTML tags and stuff like that. We're accessing the database. And here I'm using pandas. I'm importing the data from the database as a data frame. And then I'm doing some manipulation to extract what I want from it. I want the job descriptions extracted, excluding certain employers, you know, for various reasons. And then I am, you know, after doing some of that, I'm applying some functions to it that I've written elsewhere that sort of kind of take away all the parts of the job descriptions that aren't really relevant to the job itself. And then splitting it up into training and testing data sets. That's what all of this right here is doing. And then here's another function that gets it, that's taking this output where I have the categories, and then my training and my test sets, and then I'm processing it in a way that Spacy can understand. So that's what's going on right here in this function. And then I'm converting it into files, you know, outside. So this is just one whole script. So when I run this file from the command line, it will do all of this stuff. It'll access the database, process it for me, pre-process the text, put it in a form that Spacy understands, and save the file exactly where I want it to. Here's another similar example for the named entity recognition, which I was just showing in the data labeling, where in this case, we don't have to do much pre-processing because the data labeler takes care of that for you, but we're putting it in a form that Spacy can understand. And again, I can just run this from the command line, and it does exactly what I want to do and saves the files where I want it to save. Spacy in particular has this really nice, this is the config file that I made, has this really nice feature where rather than writing a training script from scratch, you can actually put in the type of model you're using and all of your hyperparameters for your machine learning model, everything you need in these config files. And then you can run that file from the command line. It will then train the model for you. So that's what all of this is. So it initializes the pipeline. Here we're doing, it's converting this part here, converts the tokens to vectors, which is an important step in natural language processing. Here we're doing multi-label text categorization. So that's to classify jobs as being computer IT jobs or as being marketing jobs or as being HR jobs, whatever. That's what that part of the machine learning model is doing. And then we also have, let's see, what else are we doing here? We're doing part of speech tagging and sentence parsing. And then down here we have all of the standard, if you know deep learning neural networks, the various hyperparameters you use, the type of optimizer and so on and so forth. So that's what all this stuff is. So it does take a little while to get used to this format. You have to learn the spacey way of doing things, but once you learn it, it's very, very handy. And if you get into natural language processing, I do recommend looking into this. But then I can run this from the command line and it will output a trained model. And it will have stats on how well the model does, so you can train it many times if you need to. And one of the things that Spacey does that's very, very handy is it can package together various machine learning models in one pipeline. So I can run this config file. This particular one doesn't have the name entity recognition, but I could certainly add that in. And it'll train a named entity recognition model, it'll train text categorization, and whatever else I need. It can do a lot of different types of text-based models. And then when you deploy it, you just load it, and it's one model, one pipeline that you can then use on text. So you can apply the model to the text, and it'll categorize it for you, do the named entity recognition, do everything all at once, where normally you may have to have one model for text categorization, another model for named entity recognition, and it may not even be the same Python library that you can do for both, because maybe one library can't do everything that you want to do. So that's kind of a nice feature. So then you end up with a trained machine learning model and you have to deploy it. And so we have various scripts that do that for us. This is a script actually just to do, this is actually mainly to do with matching job categories. So here we have a whole bunch of scripts that are used to match, to decode both resumes and job descriptions and associate them with certain job categories. We use a lot of functional programming here, which is why you just see one function after another. Here's one that I wrote that extracts, skills. So we have, here I label skills, right? So like C#, Unix, Linux, whatever it is. And then the machine learning model, you can train it to extract those skills, but now you've extracted them, what do you do with it? So here's a function, for example, that will extract all of those skills by finding them in a job description, or you can use it on a resume, and then it ends up being a set. So you have one for the user, one for the job, and then that's one of the things that we use to help match users to jobs. How well do they, out of all of these skills this job is asking for, how many of them does this user have based on what they put in the resume? Here's another example. This one's more of like deploying machine learning. So here we're using both Spacey and some of the cool Spacey features like their phrase matcher. Here I'm using a machine learning library, sentence transformers, for deploying kind of high level transformer based models. So here's one that I'm using, this Distilbert based model, which is a variation on BERT models, which is a very, very popular type of machine learning model and very powerful for anything natural language processing. So what this is actually doing is computing text similarity. So it's taking a job description and then we pre-process it to take out all of the stuff that's not relevant to the job itself and convert that into vectors, just long, you know, long sequences of numbers. Then we do the same thing with the resume. And then I use, in this case, we're using cosine similarity to see how close those vectors are together. But what that really ends up meaning is how similar the text is. So this is another thing that we use to see if what the resume is talking about is the same thing as what the job description is talking about. And that's what a lot of this is. And Spacy has some really cool features. Here I've written a function, and what this does is, so we job descriptions are very much unstructured, so they don't necessarily have neatly defined sentence beginnings and ends. You have, you know, lots of bullet points and things like that. So when I separate it, I create some extra space between any, if it's a sentence and it doesn't have a period, I create some extra space there. And what this function is saying is, it's telling Spacy, if you see, you know, two collections of words that have more than a couple of spaces between them, those are distinct sentences. So treat them as distinct sentences. And then here I'm feeding it into a pipeline. So then Spacy has its own parser, which, you know, figures out the subject of a sentence, the object of a sentence, and it uses that to determine sentence boundaries. So I'm telling it, first, you know, look for these spaces, and then those are sentence boundaries. And then for anything that, you know, you still need to figure out as a sentence boundary, you can use the parser for that. So it's very powerful how you can kind of mix and match tools in this way. Whereas a lot of simpler natural language processing, you kind of just, you know, separate out the sentences and words and feed it into models and hope for the best. And then we have different functions that we've written to, you know, extract phrases and words that we're looking for. And then it, basically what the rest of this is it's turning the, like I said, it's turning the text into vectors, numerical vectors, and then computing the similarity, the cosine similarity between them. And then that goes into a final score. So this all gets deployed. And so, for example, you can see that on a website that we use for our own internals. Here you have candidates, and then you have these scores associated with particular jobs, in this case, the software engineering job. And so we can also mix this with human elements. So if their score is above a certain amount, then, you know, an employer may automatically see them as a recommended candidate. So it basically ends up being artificial intelligence that's recommending candidates for a job, or a user, you know, a person who works in talent operations, for example, can come in here and they can click on the users to try to find more information about them and boost them if they want, or maybe some of the ones that are kind of borderline in terms of their score, we can go in and take a closer look and see if they are someone that we, you know, can recommend and tell the employer to take a closer look at or not.